With any performance engine, reliability and reducing wear while maintaining maximum performance is obviously a key aspect. And one of the applications that can be used to help in this area is performance coatings on these engine parts. We're here with Gary from Calico Coatings to talk a little bit about the engine coatings available and how they can help. So Gary, for a start, there are a huge number of coatings that are available for your internal engine components. One of the ones I want to find out a little bit more about is DLC. So can you tell us, for a start, what does DLC stand for?
DLC is an acronym for diamond-like carbon coatings, and they're used primarily in race engines.
And what sort of components would you be applying that DLC coating to?
You normally see DLC coatings in wristbands and valves, typically on the intake side, although you do see more and more use on the exhaust side as well.
And when you're applying that coating, so what is the physical process that you go through in order to apply that coating to a fresh component?
DLCs are applied in a vacuum chamber. You clean the parts very well. That's key to getting a good DLC. And they have to have an extremely good finish on them. We typically like to see DLC parts in the 2 micro inch category before we coat it. Although you can get away with a little more depending on the application. And then once you put them into a vacuum chamber, it goes into a deep vacuum, 3 to 4 turns below atmospheric pressure. And gases are introduced into the chamber, and molecules are broken, and then the plasma is created, and it's attracted to the part. Basically, it slams it apart and becomes part of the part. And they're typically very thin, at about 2 to 3 microns in thickness.
Now, that was actually the next part I wanted to talk about. Even though they are very thin, is there a need? If, for example, you are coating a wrist pin, we see that applied to, with DLC being applied to wrist pins quite frequently, is there a need to account for that in the wrist pin to pin boss clearance inside the piston?
Normally, we would tell an engine builder to go with the normal clearances they typically do when they first start using any coating. And then what you'll find is coatings will allow you to run thinner lubricants and tighter clearances to control your oil scavenging inside the motor a little better. And you slowly close that up until you start seeing some detriment, and then open it back up like you would in any good engine builder would do.
So it's just an iterative process to find out where the happy place is for that particular component with the coating.
Correct. And you'll find that you can run tighter clearances with oils or DLCs and dry film lubricant type coatings than you normally do, but you just don't want to jump right off into it if you've never done it before.
It could be an expensive mess in the end.
Absolutely, because we can't account for everything that's going on. There's a lot of lubricants out there, and you absolutely can run thinner lubricants when you start running coatings as well, but you're going to have to play with that some.
All right, so let's just focus on that wrist pin again. So where would you see the advantages in a DLC-coated wrist pin compared to the non-coated component? Are we talking about frictional reduction? Are we talking about life expectancy? Or is it a combination?
Well, it's a combination. You DLC-coat a pin with a good DLC coat and a good pin material. There's a lot of different type pin materials, and any engine builder will tell you that. But pin materials are relevant to the type of engine it's going in. Then you put a DLC coating on it, and it's going to give you a lot better lubrication properties, and it'll allow you to tighten those clearances up, and then you can run thinner oils, and it'll give you a lot greater life. And you'll typically get, with a DLC coated wrist pin, for example, you'll get the life of the material as opposed to the life of the coating is where you'll be at.
So the coating is not going to wear off, is what you're saying there?
Correct.
Just to put some perspective on it, and obviously it's going to depend very much on the size of the wrist pin, but could you give us some idea of the cost of a DLC coating on a wrist pin?
Well, your typical average wrist pin, say for your small block or big block Chevys and Fords, run from about $28 to $32 per pin.
All right, so moving on, the other component you talked about there with the DLC coating was valves, and a slightly different aspect with the application of that coating. Why are you DLC coating valves, and where's the advantage?
Well, you coat them for the relatively same reason. It's a lubrication between the seat and the valve face. When they had leads in fuels, wasn't really a problem because the lead served as a lubrication. When the EPA came in and started taking lead out of fuels, race and world had to follow that suit. So being a good friendly partner that we are, so we had to come up with ways to lubricate that contact. And DLC became the accepted form of lubrication between the face and the seat of the valve.
Now, safe to assume that if you are going to DLC coat a valve, then the engine machinist is going to need to cut the valve face before it's coated?
Yes, everything needs to be done, and then the valve, of course, has to have that same finish on it. And that's where you get a little tricky from applicator to applicator, because you don't ever want to do things to a valve as an applicator, like roll the edges over, because that's going to kill the performance of the engine. And it doesn't take very much on that valve seat to kill the horsepower of the motor.
Now, you're also talking about alternatives to the DLC coating on the valves as well for reducing wear, particularly in dirt track engines. Can you talk about the coatings available there?
Normally in a dirt application, you wouldn't use a DLC. You'd use a chrome nitride. We call it a CRN coating. Does the same thing, but it's a little harder. Doesn't have quite the lubrication properties, but it holds up a lot better to a dirty environment, which like a 360 sprint car or something, you know, it's going to see. Whereas when you get into the aesthetics of a NASCAR Cup engine, it doesn't see near the trash going through the motor. A dirt sprint car will, for sure.
So to sort of break that down, the DLC coating, the NASCAR NASCAR Cup motor, that would be where you'd apply that because of the cleanliness of the engine, the way it's being used with a sprint car engine, because of the dirt, it's going to end up ingesting, the chrome nitride coating would be better?
That would be my recommendation, and that's what we tend to see out in the real world when the coatings are being used and the engine builders are asking for certain applications of coatings. You see, that's certainly how it breaks out most often.
The next natural question, particularly as it applies to the valves there, is when the engine is freshened up and the valve seats need to be, or valve faces need to be recut, where's that leave us with a DLC or a chrome nitride coating? Can the valve be reused, or does it need to be refaced and then sent back for coating again?
It's not typically recommended that you do that, but it is possible to do that on a chrome nitride valve. Would never recommend it on a DLC valve. There's no good way to strip a DLC off of a valve. We typically work with titanium valves, but normally these coatings are going to survive the valve, life of the valve. The valve's going to start tulipping or cupping or stretching beyond its life before you're going to need to do that. But you can see that in some of the lower budget teams with the CRN valve. It's possible to strip it off. It's possible to do it there, but I wouldn't recommend it on a DLC valve.
In most instances, the DLC coating essentially is going to outlive the valve. You're going to throw that part away and replace it with a freshen up, essentially.
Oh, absolutely. Hands down. These coatings are really, really tough. They're very thin, but man, they're tough.
All right, so moving on, the other aspect I wanted to talk about is the coatings that you can apply to a bearing. And this is something I've had no personal experience with. The general sort of consensus out there in the industry is that the bearing surfaces really shouldn't be coming into metal-to-metal contact between the bearing surface and the crankshaft journal. It's being protected by an oil film. And if that's the case, then it would stand to reason that a coating on the surface should really give us no advantage. So what's the actual truth there?
Well, you're 100% correct. There should never be metal-to-metal contact on a bearing. And as long as there's an oil film between a bearing and a crank, I don't have any particular preferences to a brand of bearing. I think they're all good bearings, and I think they'll all hold up to the manufacturer's life. But what the real world sees is that there is metal-to-metal contact. If there were no metal-to-metal contact, you'd never lose a bearing, but we know that happens, right? So those moments of time when there is that contact, that's when it's a really good time to have a secondary source of lubrication, which is what a bearing coating is. It's not a primary source of lubrication. In most cases, it's not even a real good lubricant in a wet environment, because typically most engine bearings are used some type of molybdenum disulfide type coating as a load bearing capacity. Molys don't normally lube well in oil. It's just not the nature for them. They're good dry film lubricants, but not oil. So most companies like ourselves and other companies, we put other things in there with it to give it the lubrication properties, which we can't really get into a lot of that. But you need that moly for that load bearing capacity. So we typically say that bearing coatings are a moly-based coating, because that's generally the base of the body of the coating. And
so that moly in the coating, that basically prevents the coating just being squashed out under the high load. That's what you're saying there?
Absolutely, absolutely. Otherwise, you know, a typical, say, a Teflon by itself, it just squished right out like jelly. You can't have that, you know, it's mush up. So you want that low carrying capacity. So most of them are Moly-based coatings. And they will allow that bearing to hold up for that momentary loss of oil pressure, or that momentary loss when you first start the motor where you don't have good oil pressure. And that's what a secondary source of lubrication is good for. And it will allow you to generally, over time, tighten your oil clearances up, because it does provide a good source of lubrication. And that's what it's used for.
All right, so there's a couple of aspects I want to touch on there. So the first one, just to really sort of wrap up what you're saying there, it's essentially the coating could be considered a safety backstop for when we get into those situations, which we hopefully should never be getting into, with metal-to-metal contact, basically giving you the ability to potentially live through that situation without instantly sort of damaging a bearing?
Absolutely. I mean, we race. We're racers. The company was built on racers. We race right now. We have race cars that compete every weekend. And so we know that what we see typically when we're starting to have engine trouble is the oil light will tip on. The driver radio in, the oil light's on only in the corner. Only it goes off on the straightaway. Well, you're about to run into trouble, that happens. Well, it's a good time to have a coated bearing in there to get you to the end of that race without blowing the motor up.
All right, so the second aspect you mentioned there, just talking about the clearances. So obviously you're building up the thickness of that bearing material. We already talked about the thickness of the DLC coating. I'm not quite sure how that relates to the thickness of what you're applying to the bearing, but does the engine builder need to take this into account when setting clearances?
Yes, he does. We typically would tell a new coating user, go with the clearances you currently use and size just like you normally would with the coating on the bearing, measure the bearings out. Run the motors, get comfortable with the coating and what it looks like. And then you start slowly tightening your clearances up. And you'll see that you typically will be able to tighten up a considerable amount with a coated bearing over a non-coated bearing. But now what that number is depends on the engine builder, the application, the RPMs, all that.
So can you give us some of the advantages in a competition engine of being able to tighten up that oil clearance, get that a little bit narrower or smaller? Where do we see those gains?
Well, that gets back to your scavenging of oil. You don't want oil splashing around in a motor because that's parasitic load on the crank and all, and just slows the motor down, and that's not good. So, you know, it's going to help you out there because you're going to be able to control that oil. You're going to be able to run thinner oils and than you normally typically might would. And those are probably your biggest advantages there.
And the thinner oil reduces your frictional losses inside of the engine while it's operating?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right, look, it's been great to get some insight into those coatings, Gary. And if people want to find out more about Calico coatings, where can they go to?
You can go to www.calicocoatings.com. And our call our office, we love to talk to people. We help with a lot of engine problems. I mean, typically, you're calling us because you have a problem. If everything's sunny and clear in 72, we don't get very many of those calls.
Perfect. Thanks for the chat.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.